So thanks a lot for coming to this session. My name is Oleg Nenashev. I'm going to present a talk about continuous integration in hardware and embedded software areas. Let me introduce myself. So probably you know me as an active Jenkins CI contributor, but actually I'm a hardware and embedded engineer with about 10 years of experience, and I've also been involved to many hardware automation projects and continuous integration from EDA software. And at my previous companies, I worked at Intel, Synopsys, and several big Russian hardware companies. I used to maintain a department-wide continuous integration frameworks. Actually, it means large-scale Jenkins installations. So in addition to hardware-specific, you get all scalability issues which are being discussed on other talks on this conference. I'm not going to go too deep into this topic. Currently, I'm a Jenkins developer at CloudBees. I've joined 2 months ago in order to extend Jenkins and to provide more features, including hardware and embedded areas. And I'm also a PhD student at St. Petersburg State Polytechnical University. And I'm going to finish my education soon. Regarding Jenkins, I have about 6 years of Hudson and Jenkins experience and 3 years of open source contribution. I've developed pretty much plugins. You can see several examples on the slide. So they are mostly related to tool belts and ownership-based security. In addition to this plugin, I've also developed many closed-source plugins for hardware and electronic design automation tools, but unfortunately, they are not available in open source now. Today, I'm going to briefly present continuous integration and in the hardware and embedded world. I'm going to cover several typical use cases like EDA tools, FPGA farms, computing grids, etc. And at the end of the presentation, I'll briefly describe CloudBees Jenkins platform features which may be useful for hardware projects. Probably you think that Jenkins is a tool for continuous integration in software, but actually it's not true. Almost every company in the world uses Jenkins for its purposes, not only for development. You can use it for operations. You can use for your accounting automation, and almost for everything. Jenkins is a framework. And there are pretty much hardware companies using Jenkins. And actually, there are pretty much activities on hardware conferences related to continuous integration and Jenkins. You can see several references on this slide. And actually, today we are having another hardware-related talk by Sarah Woodall. It will be conducted at 4 p.m. So this is very related to the topic I'm presenting today. I'm going to briefly describe CI specifics in our world. So what's hardware product? Actually, this is a big set of products of different size and different complexity. It can be a simple trigger or microcontroller, or it may be a complex system on the chip like modern processor cores. And there can be integrated devices like cell phones or even planes on this slide. So almost everything can be considered as a hardware product. In addition, there are also products oriented for development purposes. For example, AP libraries, it's a reusable blocks, so you can ship a block, sell them, and then it will be used by other hardware engineers to design their own devices. And there are also prototype board development kits, and all these things can be considered as hardware products. If you talk about hardware development flow, it's very similar to software development. So if you just change terms, you'll see the same flow. In hardware, we use different languages to program architectures of hardware, for example, VHDL, Verilog, but they're similar to programming languages. And we also synthesize our products and actually compile them and link and then optimize to get a better solutions. So the flow is similar to software, and even if you have never worked with hardware, you can develop several tools. I have a question to Audrey. Who has ever worked with hardware tools and who has ever developed something for them? Oh, cool. Much more than I've expected. On the previous JUC, there were about 10 people. So that's great. Actually, hardware processes and hardware design approaches go beyond software development tools. So continuous integration of software started about 10 years ago. And now it's been widely adopted in hardware development approaches, not probably 15 years. But yes, the fact is that new methodologies are being adopted in hardware later than in software. So when you work with software, you can predict what will happen with hardware development approaches soon. And you can use these opportunities in order to prepare your environments and to prepare your solutions for hardware customers. This is an example of continuous integration in hardware area. So suppose it's just a Jenkins job where we check out the data from source control management systems, then somehow set up environment, run the build. Usually it's synthesized, placed, and wrote. But yes, in general, we build something. Then we run analysis, which may include static analysis, formal verification, and timing analysis, which is similar to performance analysis software. Then we run testing, which also includes unit tests, integration tests, system tests, etc. And then we want to publish reports and deploy artifacts. So the common hardware development flow is very similar to software one, but we use another tools called electronic design automation tools. Actually, there is a huge area and a huge market which allows hardware companies to develop their own hardware. And these tools require much resources, so it's common to parallelize every step of the build. And I'm going to briefly cover parallelization approaches later. Regarding embedded software, I wouldn't go deep in this direction because embedded software is a subclass of common software. So build and testing procedures are almost similar, but sometimes you need to perform integration tests against your hardware. And this is another the topic, and it requires much more integrations and much more infrastructure than common software development flows. But actually, it's just a case for integration tests. So what's a common hardware IP product? It's an integrated product which includes full packages, including documentation. So when you want to ship something reusable, and when you want to ship something which can be used by other developers, you need much more than just a hardware and embedded software. You need your own development tools and IDEs. For example, if you ship a processor, you need compilers, you need simulators, and all this stuff should be created for your processor core. Then you need demo hardware and demo software to demonstrate your tool. You need to provide development kits, which will be used by developers later. And actually, all of this stuff is your are parts of your products, and they also include external software and IPs, for example, verification flows. And if you want to set up a continuous integration for hardware product, you have to consider all these components in your development flows. So it's it causes many issues because there are many technologies and many tools used by different types of components, and you need to integrate everything in your continuous integration infrastructure. And in addition to common network problems, you get many problems with hardware. So when you develop hardware, you run tests on specific machines, and if something breaks, it's hard to diagnose these issues, and you need to somehow monitor the behavior on the Jenkins side. So it requires much efforts to stabilize and infrastructure and keep it going. And another specific of hardware area is that So hardware array is quite older than software one, and many products come from 90s, and they include much legacy software, for example, build scripts on Windows Batch, Shells, Tkl, and they can be frameworks containing millions of code lines. So you can just rework them, and you have to somehow integrate it in your flows. And another specifics of hardware that hardware engineers are not software experts, so you shouldn't expect them to write great scripts and to write the reliable solutions. So when you run the scripts on your continuous integration environment, you should be ready that something breaks and they can come to you and blame you because your Jenkins broke everything. It's a common situation and you need to handle it. And as always, continuous integration teams have limited resources. In addition, hardware companies are very aware about their IP, so they don't easily allow to use open source solutions. They don't easily allow to contribute your changes to open source. So compared to software, hardware is much more closed. So we know that many companies use Jenkins, but there is no open source plugins in the Jenkins Update Center, and it causes issues for other companies. But yes, we have to work in such environment. But why we use Jenkins? So the first reason is that Jenkins is the most popular continuous integration tool in the world, and it applies for hardware as well. And the second reason is that it's a framework. So if you have Jenkins, you can automate almost everything by using common steps or just by using scripts. If you take specialized electronic design automation tools, or if you take software continuous integration tools, like BuildBot, TeamCity, they're quite universal as well. But compared to Jenkins, they have limitations, which create many obstacles when you create continuous integration flows on them. Jenkins can be easily used as a cron with a web interface. So cron is being widely used by hardware engineers to run their continuous integration, and you can just provide them a web interface, and after that start migrating your flows to modern Jenkins features and providing much added value by it. Another reason that Jenkins open source, so when you work with hardware, you commonly use non-common cases. And when you use non-common cases of Jenkins, something usually breaks. But in case of Jenkins, you can apply patches and stabilize your environment. And the additional advantage is that you can use long-term supported versions of Jenkins core. Actually, 3 months is not long-term for hardware world. If you say 5 years, it would be okay, but not 3 months. But it's better than nothing, and Jenkins LTS cores can be stabilized, and you can continue maintaining it in your own infrastructure by backporting features, bug fixes, etc. And if you cannot do it on your own, you can always purchase a commercial support for Jenkins from any company, including CloudBees, of course. But Jenkins is not isolated. So if you take a simple continuous integration system like Circle, CI, Travis, etc., there are a very limited number of companies providing commercial support. In the case of Jenkins, almost every software integrator is ready to provide you support, plugin development, if you pay enough money, of course. So that's all with a not so brief introduction. Now I'm going to present several area-specific topics. Probably you will find something useful for software tasks as well. But yes, it includes many hardware specifics. So when you build hardware on Jenkins, you need the electronic design automation tools. And unfortunately, there is almost no integrations available on open source. The only exception, as I know, is Cadence vManager plugin, but actually it automates integration with one tool. But if you run your design flow, you need dozens of tools even to compile a simple project. And commonly, hardware companies provide tools for different platforms. Actually, electronic design automation tool may cost $100,000. So there is no significant difference in the case of operating system cost, etc. So the most of hardware companies support a limited number of operating systems and a limited number of Linux distributions. So if you want to use it on your Jenkins infrastructure, you need to somehow provide an environment which allows to run all tools, and actually you have to distribute builds across multiple tools because every tool has its own supported operating systems and platforms. And sometimes you need multiple versions of a single tool. For example, if you synthesize several components for an integrated system, every component may require its own system. And unfortunately, when you change a tool version in Jenkins, you lose, not in Jenkins, in the hardware world, you may lose your optimizations, which have been done manually on the last stages of the development. So hardware companies frequently stick to a particular version and don't upgrade till it works and been supported by the vendor. So you need multiple versions, and since tools may require much space, you cannot use common tool installers in Jenkins. You need another solution, and another issue is related to limited licenses. So when you use hardware tools, you have to somehow share licenses with external users, and you need additional features which would allow such sharing. I'll briefly cover this case. So regarding EDA software, the approach we've been using at previous companies is to store tools on shared folders. So you have a big repository of tools, and then you just install this tool to Jenkins environment. And for this purpose, I used custom tools plugin, and I also implemented extra tool installers plugin, which provide a stub installer with a pass without any installation steps. So if you use Unix or Windows without a service, everything works out of the box because you can just attach shared folder and use it. If you use a Windows service, the situation is more complex because Windows services do not map drives by default. So we expect Windows Service Wrapper, it's an open source component of Jenkins, to map these directories. But unfortunately, the current version doesn't support it. So there is a pull request created by me about 6 months ago, but we haven't merged it yet. But if anybody is interested, I can provide a local build for such tool. So custom tools was initially developed by Ryan Campbell. And then I took ownership of this plugin and implemented several features required to complex hardware tools. So now the plugin allows to create configurable installers, set up an environment, including path variables, environment variables, and all of them, these ones can be configured on a per label basis. So you can set up different environment for Linux, Windows, or probably other label combinations. And you also can use built-in versioning based on extended choice. Probably it wasn't a good approach. If somebody uses extended choice, you probably know issues being caused by this plugin and its backward compatibility. I regret this decision, but currently I have to use it in this plugin. But I'm going to implement the extension point later. So, I'm not sure this picture is big enough. This is an example of custom tools configuration. Actually, you may see that it's quite complex, and it consists of several main sections. The first one is a usage of tools from a specified directory, and you can use environment variables there. So every node can specify its own path to shared tools, and you can also inject environment variables for versions, etc. Then you can set up extra environment for different nodes. For example, if I use EDA tool, the common issue is to use license servers being provided by Flex License Manager. And the main specifics of this tool that it requires different format of environment variable for Linux and Windows. This is the difference is one of one list separated symbol, but you need such custom environment to set up it. And in order to set up multiple tools, there are another option which allows to set up these options, and actually you can specify versions locally, or if you share these versions across Jenkins instances, you can specify remote property files and property keys, and then implement an automatic deployment of tools with automatic update of files provided versioning. So new installations can be provided out of the box. And in the case of job, you just need to specify a tool to be used, and optionally you can specify a version as a build parameter. And after that, a user who runs your job just gets this parameter in a configuration file. So when I click on build button, I get a list of versions, and actually in my scripts, I can use my EDA tools without any other configurations. So all the setup procedure is transparent for user. And actually, this solution really helps to simplify build scripts. Another common issue with EDA software is publishers. For build steps, you commonly don't need plugins because any electronic design automation tool has a command line interface. Actually, the most of tools have no graphical interface at all. But for builds, you can just use command line interface and get results. So there is no problem. But when you want to publish these results on Jenkins, you get into the issue with missing plugins. So the common cases in hardware are similar. I want to publish unit tests, I want to publish performance test results, coverages, and I have no plugins for it. So currently there is no other approach except in conversion of data formats from hardware tools format to a supported open source one. For example, if you want to publish a coverage, you can take a data from any XML-based format and then convert it to Cobertura format and then just use a common plugin. The same approach is applicable for unit tests and for performance coverages. So it's not very handy, but if you use a limited setup of tools, you can implement all these converters only once, then run them as additional publisher step and get results out of the box without writing your own plugin. So this is the most simple approach we've been using on many Jenkins installations. And actually, it explains why we don't have much hardware, because you can write a XLT converter, including 100 lines of specification. But after that, you get a format compatible with common open tools for software. So you don't need anything else. And this approach is OK. Regarding software licenses, the situation is more difficult. So if you work with hardware, you know that Flex License Manager is being used almost everywhere. So this is a de facto standard. Yes, and the main problem of this License Manager is a shared usage. You cannot use dedicated licenses because licenses are very expensive, and the common case is to let users use your licenses during the working day and run nightly builds and use the licenses on automation infrastructure. But unfortunately, Flex License Manager doesn't support provisioning of licenses by time, and there is no sporadic prioritization. So if my license request hangs in queue for hours, I don't get an additional priority, and it strongly affects users outside the automation infrastructure. And the only solution we can do on Jenkins now is to use throttling and to somehow limit the usage of licenses on the infrastructure. So the common approach is to use throttling, or you can implement when wait for a license script, taking time requirements into account. But actually, this is a hacking, and you must ensure that all jobs follow the policies. So it's quite complex. And personally, I would prefer to have a FlexLM plugin, but there is no open source ones for it. Probably hardware companies have their own implementations, but we don't know about them. When you run hardware tests, there are three main approaches. Firstly, you use simulators. This is a specific EDA tools. Then you can run hardware-based tests on FPGAs or designed ASIC prototypes. And in addition, you can use combined approaches. So for example, a simulator which somehow accelerates the testing by reusing hardware. They are pretty much such solutions. But commonly, you have to use software or hardware. And if you use a software-based solution, unfortunately, tests are very complex. They require thousands of CPU hours. They require much temporary data for temporary files and reports, and they consume much memory. So you cannot go to the cloud and deploy your tests there like you do in software, because it won't be cost effective. You will pay much for a cloud and you will get nothing because you will have to maintain your own infrastructure, your platforms. And that's why hardware companies mostly use computing grids instead of private clouds. So the computing grid is a set of physical machines integrated by additional dispatcher, which runs tasks and provides results. And these big installations have been shared across departments. So it's a common case when a computing grid takes several data centers in a big hardware company. And actually, there are several examples of computing grid software like SunGrid Engine, LSF, and NetBatch, which has been used at Intel and several other companies and others. So this software is slightly different from cloud provisioners, but it follows the same purpose. You can get more resources from a computing grid from your Jenkins installation, and there are several approaches. The first one is to manage tasks from command line interface. For example, if you have a legacy script which uses CLI of your computing grid, you can do everything there, but you have to somehow handle the terminations of jobs in Jenkins. You have to pull status from computing grids, etc. And actually, it becomes complex because computing grids have dozens of configurations for every build, and it's very difficult to set up everything. And another issue is that you split the execution to two instances. Firstly, you execute something on Jenkins side, for example, checkout from SCM. And then in your internal scripts, you call computing grid. So another approach would be to use Jenkins nodes within computing grids. It's a common case for clouds. Jenkins has a cloud provider API, which allows to designate slaves on demand. And actually, we could use the same approach for computing grids. And actually, there is a plugin for LSF cloud now. But for other plugins, there is no solutions. And it would be very useful for hardware. And another approach would, which would greatly simplify the usage of Jenkins and computing grids, is to somehow implement build steps or probably workflow wrappers to run Jenkins tasks remotely on computing grids. And unfortunately, there is no solutions as well. So the current widely used approach is to use everything from CLI, but it causes much maintenance efforts. There are pretty much issues, and due to specific licenses environment. For example, nodes may be running on multiple user accounts just to get specific licenses. It's very difficult to manage the infrastructure and to troubleshoot it. So I vote for open source plugins, but yes, there is no available ones. And in order to overcome the issue with hardware simulation costs, hardware companies frequently use FPGAs. Actually, this is an electronic device where you can blast your design and get a model of a hardware working almost in real time, and you can test it. However, these FPGA boards, if you design a complex product, these FPGA boards require much resources, and actually these hubs is not the biggest thing. For example, the installations of such kind, which may cost millions of dollars per each instance, and as you may imagine, there is no opportunity to have much such instances on continuous integration environment. Most probably, you will have no dedicated FPGA farms on your installations, so you have to design another approaches. And in addition to basic FPGA issues, you also may suffer from distribution, because you cannot get hardware on one side. You just land something where you find it. You sometimes build your hardware from things you have and create boards which seem to be working, but actually they are not products and they just emulate something. And sometimes you have FPGA boards which work on Windows only due to drivers issues, and it's a common case when you have boards on a site when you have no infra team members. So you rely on somebody who restarts your board on demand when you call him, and this is the only approach you can use because there is no other solutions. And you have to bear with it and to somehow integrate your flows into continuous integration tools. So how it commonly works? If we have a Jenkins node, it may have several connections with remote FPGA board. So we need one connection to blast data. Then if we have a design which has a processor and we want to upload firmware there, we need another connections. And in addition, if something happens with the board, we may need to conduct a force restart of it. So the only way is to switch off the power, and we need another devices to manage it. And sometimes boards have local switches, which there is example, which cannot be managed on Jenkins side because there are hardware switches. So you need additional tools just to manage them. And actually, if a board costs $500, all the environment to get a reliable solution based on this board may easily cost 10,000 and consume half of room just to keep it running. So this is a horrible case, but you have to somehow bear with it on Jenkins nodes, and unfortunately, there is no generic approaches for it. At previous companies, we mostly used a step-by-step approach. So we had common steps decoupled to another projects. It could be templates, parameterized trigger to launch them. So you have a generic component to blast your FPGA, to upload firmware, to run test. For example, using GDB, commonly for processor IP tools are bundled to open source solutions that the interfaces are very simple. So common software engineers do not need to know if they run tests on hardware or on software emulation. They just need to specify several additional options. But for automation infrastructure, we should somehow handle these cases. And we also need to handle concurrent usage. So if you launch two hardware tests in parallel on a single node with a single board, nothing good will happen. And you have to throttle these builds. And if something happens, you may need to restart the build on another node. So any hardware is not reliable. So your test may fail due to infrastructure issues. And since these tests may consume hours in order to provide a result to developer, you need to somehow make decisions and restart tests on your own. And everything should be done in your projects. So for failover and automatic restart, we commonly use the Nginator plugin, which allows to implement the most of cases, allowing to restart the build according to several conditions. So for example, you can parse logs of your execution and then make a decision that it was a system failure and just restart it. And you have to parse several such cases, but after that, it will work. Regarding throttling, it's another open source plugin, which is called Throttle Concurrent Builds. Commonly, we use it to run to throttle builds by category. So we create a new category, for example, FPGA user job or something like that, which requires one build on the node. And after that, Throttle Concurrent Builds plugin will automatically dispatch all calls, and it will be done in parallel. However, there were performance issues till the latest LTS release. And these issues can be partially solved by CloudBees Jenkins Enterprise plugin called Label Throttle. However, it doesn't address all use cases of Throttle Concurrent Builds plugin. And another issue on hardware installation is that anybody have to configure his job on his own. So when you create a job, you assign a throttle configuration, and you assign a label to be run. And after that, you get a unique build on a FPGA farm, which has the desired board. But if somebody misconfigures their job, for example, forgets to set up a throttle concurrent build, you may get inter-collisions between multiple jobs. So if you want to run FPGAs reliably, you need to somehow manage these installations, and probably you need backend Groovy scripts just to analyze the usage of FPGA labels and to check if throttling is set up correctly. And if not, you can just disable the build and send email to the job developer. And actually, you also need to perform FPGAs monitoring. So common builds run occasionally, but FPGA boards may break at any moment. So it's recommended to periodically run spot checks, which somehow test your board and make a decision if the instance is stable. For example, you can use multi-configuration matrix job, which would use elastic access to find all nodes having the desired board by label. And after that, you just run common FPGA blast and can firmware tests using shared components. And if something fails, you can execute a Groovy script, which disables the node and sends emails to Jenkins administrators. So this procedure has no plugins, but actually it's quite easy to set up it, and it greatly reduces the failure times of FPGA boards. And actually the same approach can be used for any shared resources, not only for FPGAs. So that's all with hardware features. Now I want to cover several enterprise features, which in my humble opinion provide an added value for hardware cases. However, CloudBees Jenkins Enterprise and CloudBees Jenkins Platform, like it has been renamed recently, there are many features. And for me personally, the most valuable feature is support being provided by CloudBees. Trust me, it's really great. But in addition, you also get many enterprise plugins. You can also get Operations Center. It's a big Jenkins-based installation, which allows to orchestrate multiple Jenkinses within the single infrastructure. And actually, these features are really useful, but I don't cover them because they are common features being provided by CloudBees. So you can just go to docs and see what's available there. So regarding hardware products, the most complex thing we experience is duplication of data across multiple builds. So you have common build steps, which you have in different places, and you can use templates, inheritance, plugin, and job generator to somehow overcome this issue. But you still get jobs, and you have to manage dependencies manually after you create a new one. So it's complex, and CloudBees provides a template plugin, which allows to completely inherit one job from another one and reuse this functionality. So we can get rid of a common case. For example, if you use parameterized trigger, firstly, you trigger a job with parameters, then you wait till it completes. Then you take all artifacts just to analyze what has happened there, process them, and make decisions. And actually, in Jenkins, such case may require several pages of configurations, and it becomes almost unreadable for common Jenkins users who has no much experience. So in my opinion, templates greatly reduce efforts, especially for hardware tasks where you have multiple shared components without any plugins. And you can also use templates together with workflow and with Scrippler plugin. Scrippler is a solution which allows to run system Groovy scripts on Jenkins. So if you have no plugin, and if you need to do something with Jenkins core, for example, add an action display in your report, you can use Scrippler just to emulate a plugin and to inject proper data into Jenkins. So it's a common solution which allows to extend the functionality on a running instance. At my previous companies, we used to run Jenkins with about 6 months uptimes without any updates. And if something breaks there, or if you need to a custom feature just to address a hot case submitted by your users, you can use Scrippler just to hack the implementation quickly without any restarts. And after that, you can consider developing your own plugin, because Groovy scripts are not very reliable, and you can break your instance if you use them improperly. Another useful feature for me is a workflow with failover implementation. So when you run a test on FPGA, it may fail, for example, power off or something like that, and you may be interested to restart this build. If you use open source Jenkins, you can use an Nginator plugin, but the configuration becomes quite complex. But if you use workflow, you can create a try catch block, which performs blasting, testing, and if something happens, you can analyze the data and probably try another board just to see if the test works there. And this implementation is much more simple compared to what we have in open source versions of Jenkins. And another main feature addresses a case when you have multiple instances in your organization. So suppose you have one big FPGA farm, and you want to share it and use in multiple Jenkins instances. So if several groups have different Jenkinses, you cannot just implement it on open source, because there is no cross-master throttling. So there is a possibility that one Jenkins master and another one run jobs at the same time and break your FPGA test. But if you use CloudBees Jenkins Operation Center, there is a feature called Shared Slaves. So this is a slave being provisioning to masters on demand. So this feature allows to throttle usages of entire environment on a slave across multiple masters. So commonly, Jenkinses do not know about this slave, and then they acquire it from Jenkins Operations Center on demand. So you get all the throttling out of the box. And compared to open source attempts to resolve this issue, we tried German and we tried RabbitMQ to deliver jobs across multiple instances and to manage this usage. This approach saves much time. Another option is durable task. So if you run a long test, for example, endurance, it may take weeks and your connection may break. Something may also break on your Jenkins instance. You may need to restart it. And if it happens on your common Jenkins, most probably you lose the result. If you use computing grids, you can overcome this issue by using its own features, but sometimes it's not possible. For example, you cannot easily run computing grid on a Windows machine with FPGA. In such case, durable task allows to save much time because it's completely asynchronous compared to Jenkins core. So you submit the build and just pull for results, and you don't need to implement complex scripts to manage all cases. And you get independent execution of long-running tests. It greatly helps, especially when you have a flappy network across multiple sites. So there are pretty much other operation center cases, but yes, there is too much to discuss. And actually, all cases simplify the usage of Jenkins. So the usage of CloudBees Jenkins Enterprise or Jenkins Open Source is just your decision about maintenance costs. It allows to save some time in real installations. So as a summary, Jenkins is not only about software, so you can run hardware projects on it and projects of any other kinds. It's a framework. And actually, you can use Jenkins even without any specific plugins for your tools. You need more hardware to keep these tools running, but it's possible. And actually, enterprise features allow you to save some time and to decrease maintenance costs. But as I've said, it's debatable and it depends on your use cases. Personally, I have several wishes regarding hardware-related plugins. So firstly, I want to have a SunGrid Engine Cloud plugin, which would save many months for a common Jenkins instance with all handling of corner cases. I want to have FlexLM plugin. I want to have flexible Windows services to run my EDA tasks on Windows, not only for shared directories, but I also need license managers. I also need switching between users, and these things can be done on Windows Service Wrapper side, but yes, it should become much more flexible. And obviously, I would like to see much more EDA tools and plugins for them, especially for reporting. And another case I would like to see is parsing of reports and logs. So currently, EDA tools generate gigabytes of logs, and there are many open source plugins allowing to parse these logs by regular expressions and to retrieve results. And these plugins greatly simplify navigation across logs. But I want to have something being provided out of the box by EDA companies, because formats frequently change and it's almost impossible to maintain it on your own. So that's all. Do you have any questions? Yeah, probably the talk was addressing top-level hardware use cases. So if you want hardware, this talk is too abstract. But if you want on software, it's too detailed for in the scope of hardware side. But if you have any questions, I am ready to answer them. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.